Constitution. The Trouble with Gravity is a deceptively short book, only 218 pages. Deceptively short because I ended up reading many sections more than once. Not because they were badly written, but because the ideas expressed in them are so profound and so challenging. For instance, did you know that it is now thought that the distribution of mass energy in the universe is comprised of 68.3% dark energy, 26.8% dark matter, and only 4.9% ordinary matter, like protons, neutrons, and this wonderful building? But is this distribution stable or fluctuating? As head of the planning committee of this institution, I worry about this a lot. I sort of knew that no one knows what gravity is, including Newton and Einstein. And this book, I hate to disappoint you, won't answer that question either. But what I did learn is how much we don't know. Gravity is the weakest of the four major forces in the universe. There is also the strong nuclear force, governing the stability of atomic nuclei, the electromagnetic force, and the weak nuclear force that determines radioactive decay. Gravity is billions and billions times weaker than the others. And yet, it's the only force that doesn't have a quantum solution that incorporates Einstein's relativity. But on February the 11th, 2016, gravitational wavelengths were discovered for the first time, emanating from the collapse of two circling black holes, not only reconfirming Einstein's general theory on relativity, but perhaps offering new insights into the properties of gravity. Richard Panik is a Guggenheim Fellow in Science Writing. He is the author as well of The 4% Universe, which received the Science Communication Award from the American Institute of Physics, and has co-authored with Temple Grandin, The Autistic Brain. It gives me great pleasure to introduce you to Richard Panik.
I also want to thank the Society Librarian Sarah Holliday for inviting me. I've spoken here several times before. It's always such a pleasure. And we've been members since, according to the membership card I just got in the mail, we have been members since 1994. So, feel very much like this feels like home. So, where do we begin? Well, first of all, let me get this back up on the screen. I once was giving a talk, and the lights were kind of screwed up, and I was next to the light switch on the wall, and there were all these dimmer things, and I had to figure out how to do it, and I couldn't figure it out. My wife was sitting in the audience. She's over here, and she was sitting in the audience, and she told me afterwards that there was a woman sitting in front of her who said, and he calls himself a scientist. Anyway, I don't call myself a scientist because I'm not. I don't have a background in science, but I like to figure things out and then write about them. So that's what I'm doing here. So what I'm going to do tonight is read you a little bit from the book and then have a discussion about two specific aspects that I cover in the book, and I think that'll give you a sense of what where the topic goes. So, this is the introduction. It's very short. I fell. I'd been sitting in a chair for a quarter of an hour, killing time in a bookstore. I had selected from a nearby shelf a book that I thought might relate to the subject I was researching at the moment. I no longer recall what. I pushed my chair away from a communal table, crossed my legs, and opened the book to a random page. The section I turned to happened to be on gravity. What I thought about gravity before I sat down was what most people think about gravity to the extent that most people think about gravity. It's a force of nature. What I learned in the next few minutes is that it's not necessarily a force. Isaac Newton thought of gravity less as a force than as something mysterious that acts across space. Albert Einstein thought of gravity less as a force than as something mysterious that belongs to space. And quantum physicists agree with both Newton and Einstein. Gravity is something. I looked up in the book. Is gravity, I wonder, just a word, a semantic convenience, a placeholder until a better noun comes along? Something that, until we know more about it, we've agreed to call the single cause of a universe full of effects? At the time, I didn't understand the nuances of these questions. Yet, even I, someone who had experienced little curiosity about science until well into adulthood, who had cultivated a professional interest in science but had only a minimal educational background in it, who in fact had taken AP math courses in high school specifically to escape having to take science courses in college, a strategy that pretty much worked, even I could tell that I had no idea what gravity is. I gently closed the book and stood up, but not quite. My left foot, the one that had been resting flat on the floor for a quarter of an hour, was asleep. I am nearly 6'6". I don't drop gently. My fall silenced the customers in my vicinity, yet even as I righted myself, trying to hold on to the edge of the tabletop as well as my dignity, I realized that I had received a valuable reminder. You take gravity for granted at your own peril. I also recognized that I had discovered a new mission in life, the pursuit of an answer to a question I'd never thought to ask. What is gravity? And that's actually not the whole introduction, but I think I will stop there. And think about and talk about gravity in this way. So does that surprise people here that we don't know what gravity is? I'm just looking for a show of hands. So it surprised me, obviously. And I've been thinking about it recently, about how to express this idea. And I thought, because in my experience over the past few years, when I've talked to people like myself or yourselves, people who don't have a background in science, and I would say things like, we don't know what gravity is, they would say, well, sure, it's the thing that when you know, it's the force of attraction, you let go of a rock, it falls straight down to the earth. I would say, yeah, but what does that actually mean? And we would go back and forth. On the other hand, when I would speak to scientists, to physicists, I would say, we don't know what gravity is. And they would go, yeah, right, that's right. So let me take that sentence that I just gave you and break it apart. Gravity is the force of attraction that makes things fall straight down. So let's take this one piece at a time and see what this actually means. What do we mean by force? As we just heard, there are four fundamental forces, the strong nuclear, the electromagnetic, the weak nuclear, and gravity. And as you said, gravity is much weaker than the others, but here's how much weaker it is. The strong nuclear is about 100 times stronger than the electromagnetic. The electromagnetic is about up to 10,000 times stronger than the weak nuclear. The weak nuclear is 10 to the 30, that's a 1 with 30 zeros after it, times stronger than gravity. And to illustrate the point, the difference, here is a paper clip. Okay? It's a regular paper clip. If anybody wants to examine it, you're welcome. You can take my word for it. It weighs about, its mass is about a quarter of an ounce. I put it here, and the gravitational force, it, of the entire Earth is holding it down. The entire Earth is about 6.6 sextillion tons. So this quarter ounce object is being held down to the Earth by this great force. Here's another force, magnetism. It's an ordinary refrigerator magnet. Ordinary except that it has a picture of the cover on it. But otherwise, it's completely ordinary. And here we go. We're going to see if this force of magnetism can counteract the entire gravitational force of the Earth. Yeah, pretty easy. There you go. So what do we mean by force? Right? How does it fit? As you also said, that of the four fundamental forces, three of them have quantum equivalence, and one does not, and that is gravity. That is that there are quantum particles that actually correspond, that mediate with the universe to give us the effects that we call electromagnetism, etc. No such quantum particle exists for gravity, and people have been looking for a long time. That doesn't mean that it doesn't exist, it just means that they haven't found it yet, and therefore it is an outlier in that way, too. So let's get rid of force, and look at the word attraction. What do we mean by attraction? Newton himself said that he himself avoided the use of the word attraction, mutual attraction. All he said was that we can figure out the math, the formulas behind gravitational effects. And he said, we'll call them gravitational effects. But notice, we're talking about effects, not causes. So other people imposed on that, because it became so successful, you know, this as a predictive measure is math, that other people imposed on it the idea of this action at a distance, or this force of attraction. And he himself kept looking for what that might be. I mean, he thought it was going to be something physical, which is a natural idea to come up with. And he kept on thinking about that for the rest of his life, but he never got there. He never found out what it is. And we still don't know what that cause of the effect that we call gravitation is. So even Newton said, let's not call it attraction, let's just leave it a question mark. You probably heard his phrase, hypothesis non fingo, I feign no hypothesis. That's what he was talking about, that I'm not going to suggest what this thing might be because I have no evidence for it. What I can give you, though, is the math, and this math works here on Earth, and it works in the sky, and the two are actually the same thing, Earth and sky. And we will come back to that idea in a little bit. So let's get rid of attraction. Gravity is what makes things fall straight down. Okay, what do we mean by straight down? Now, if I let go of something, a rock, it's going to fall from our point of view straight down. From my point of view, it's going to hit the ground and go straight down. That's how we generally think of things as falling straight toward the middle of the Earth. However, the only reason it seems straight to us is because I'm standing still and you're standing still next to me. If you were moving, it wouldn't be falling at straight down. It would be moving at an angle. I'll show you what we mean by this. So here's somebody at the top who is going to let go of, you see the water moving down here, and he drops it, and it goes straight down. But here, the water is standing still because we are standing still. Let me go back and show you that again. So here the water is moving because we're moving and the ship is standing. We're standing still and the ship is standing still and the water is going past. But now the ship is moving, and the same wall, it's falling straight down here, right, from his point of view, but from our point of view, it's actually falling on this curve. So if you were moving relative to me and I dropped this, it would actually seem to be falling on an angle, whatever it is that I'm dropping. Now that's true wherever you are on the Earth, but what if you're standing off the Earth and you're looking at things falling? The Earth is spinning. So imagine that you are here, and you're dropping something straight down, right? It's going straight down, except it's not only going on a curve because we're moving relative to it, but it's also moving on a greater curve because the Earth is spinning. It's rotating on its axis. But it's not just rotating on its axis, it's also going around the Sun. This is to scale, by the way. The Earth and the Sun actually are that big. And the Earth moves that way. Now, But you can see the idea here that it's not all that, you know, if you were moving relative to me on the Earth, it would look different. The thing dropping down would be on an angle. The Earth is, if you were off the Earth is rotating, the angle would be more pronounced, the curve would be more pronounced. If you were looking at the Earth then going around the Sun, it would be even more pronounced. And here, and we have come to think of the solar system as looking like this, right? I mean, this is very exaggerated. The elliptical orbits are very exaggerated, but, and of course it's not to scale, but it's the idea there that, you know, you look at it this way and you say, okay, it's, things are rotating. So here's the Earth we were just talking about. The Earth is rotating and it's moving around the Sun. But if you look at it, that's this kind of view that you're looking at it from above, and that's how we tend to think about the solar system when we talk about elliptical orbits, right? We see, but that's our prejudice. In fact, not only is the Earth rotating, and not only is it revolving around the Sun, but the Sun itself is revolving around the center of the galaxy. And so it actually, the Earth's movement actually looks a little more like this. The planets here, the inner planets are, if you were to freeze it and look from above, quote unquote from above, as we did in the previous slide, it would look like, you know, like they're all spinning around the Sun, but the Sun is moving through the galaxy, and therefore these things are hardly looking like ellipses. If you're standing still, they would, but they are actually making all of these other motions. And so if you look at it from that way, you say, well, what does it mean to fall straight down? So if you're looking at, if you're moving relative to me, it's not falling straight down. The Earth is rotating. The Earth is revolving. The rotating Earth is revolving around the Sun. The Sun is revolving around the center of the galaxy. And the galaxy itself is moving. And the universe, excuse me, the universe is expanding. And the acceleration and the expansion is accelerating. So we have all these motions going on. So saying that something falls straight down is problematical unless you happen to be standing absolutely still relative to that person. And we can see that Einstein wrote about this in developing his special theory. This is something he wrote in his notebooks after publishing the general theory of relativity. And he used the example of Mount Vesuvius, that you can say that Mount Vesuvius erupted and then it erupted again, but you can only say that it erupted in the same place relative to Mount Vesuvius. You can't say relative to anything else. And here he says, what I was just saying here, the Earth rotates about its axis, it moves around the Sun, and furthermore moves together toward the constellation of Hercules. And now we would say that the universe is expanding and the expansion is accelerating. So he says, from this example, it is seen that no sense can be attributed to such statements. So, two eruptions of Mount Vesuvius occur at different times, but at the same place that is at the crater of Mount Vesuvius, only relative to the crater of Mount Vesuvius. As he says here, this is just what we saw before. The same place relative to Earth, relative to the Earth. Is that, anybody, does that make sense? Okay, so we had gravity is what makes things fall straight down. Now we're gonna have gravity is what makes things fall. By fall, well, yeah, I mean, relative to me, the thing is falling towards the Earth, but relative to the object, the Earth is actually rising toward it. And if we say that actually gravity is a mutual interaction, then you can see more clearly that it actually is a mutual interaction, and two things are having this gravitational influence on each other, no matter where they are in the universe. If there were two atoms of hydrogen 13 billion light years apart, they would still be interacting gravitationally. in some way. So the same thing is true, the earth rising toward the rock falling toward the earth, the sun, I'm sorry, the moon, we say it's in an orbit, but it's actually falling toward the earth, except it keeps on correcting itself so that it never actually falls to the earth. And the earth, by the same sense, is falling toward the moon. And they're all falling toward the sun, and the sun's falling toward us, and so on and so forth. So, okay, gravity doesn't make things fall, which leaves us with this. And you heard me ask the question in the introduction, and I'll tell you something that I actually asked this of, you know, I said that most physicists, when I ask them, they say, you know, they say, that's right, we don't know what gravity is. And I asked Kip Thorne, who won the Nobel for making the discovery of the gravitational waves that we heard about earlier, and he said to me, that's a meaningless question. So that's also in the introduction. That kind of propelled me forward on this book to figure out what does a meaningless question actually mean.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, please.
Well, if you just look at the stark difference between what you think of as something falling here in our atmosphere, and you think of an astronaut floating sort of almost randomly through space, doesn't that show something about gravity?
Well, it does show something about gravity, that the gravitational effect that the astronaut is experiencing is much less than it is on Earth. I mean, there is a proportional relationship between what between the two objects. We just don't understand, on some levels, we don't understand why that interaction works the way that it works.
Okay.
So this is there will be questions afterwards too. But if I'm not clear about something, please feel free to ask while this is going on. So right now we have the statement of gravity is. So that's kind of the scientific portion of this talk, such as it is. And now I want to talk a little bit about how gravity, why we think about gravity without thinking about gravity, why we acknowledge gravity's existence without thinking about it. And that's because from the beginning, the horizon defines our relationship with the universe. This is an actual photo of the horizon. I'm not sure what is above and below. Maybe it's water. I don't actually know. But it is the horizon. And we identify with this because it's where we are. And that up there remains mysterious to us because we can't get there, or we haven't been able to get there traditionally. And in fact, during my research, I started writing that creation myths as I was looking at them because of this divide, that I kept saying, wow, I mean, the creation myths really seem to be all beginning with the idea of a division of earth and sky. And then I read this scholar from the mid-20th century who said the division of earth and sky is the primeval division in creation myths. I was like, oh, cool, I'm onto it. But, so we have this division, and because up there is mysterious and down here is mundane, from the Latin mundanus, which is means of the earth, that mysterious we start to endow with qualities like mystery and positive qualities and gods and things like that. And down here it's kind of a mess. And eventually, we go, that not only is down here a mess, but down there is even messier. That's where hell is. And then we get, this kind of construct. And I chose this slide just because it very clearly shows that kind of horizon delineation. And, you can see this throughout history. You can see this in art here. Here's hell, there's heaven, and, there are the intermediaries. And we see this throughout myths, and you see it right through Dante's Inferno, where Virgil and Dante, the character, keep going farther and farther down until finally they reach the middle of the earth because Dante knew that the Earth is round. And we were just discussing this beforehand, that Aristotle knew that the Earth is round. And it was common knowledge, and unlike what we've often been taught, that it took Columbus to prove it. Now, Columbus knew the world was round. He was wrong about the size of it, but he knew that it was round. And all you have to do is look at the shape of the Earth during a lunar eclipse, when you see that that the Earth is casting a shadow on the moon, and it's circular. So, and there are other pieces of evidence that Aristotle put together. So, so Dante and Virgil reach the center of the Earth, and then they kind of contort themselves and they start moving in a different direction. And Dante actually asks Virgil, why are we going back up? He says, well, we're not going back up. We've actually turned, and now we're going towards the other way. And we are going up, but we're going up in the opposite direction from where we came. And so there's this whole idea of, you know, breaking through the Earth, and then you're going up again. So this idea of up and down is just part of who we are. It's something that, as I say in the book, it's something we feel in our bones, literally. And in fact, I learned through my research that what we think of as walking, scientists think of as falling. They say it's a controlled fall, that with every step, you are actually surrendering to gravity, and you're falling forward, and then you stop yourself, and that's taking a step. And this happens again and again. So that whole rhythm, so the whole, this whole idea, this whole visual idea, this visceral idea of standing on the Earth, it's in our walking, it's how we learn to walk, it's how we pull ourselves up, has become part of our culture, our civilization, how we think. And for instance, here's the Aristotelian narrative arc. And the reason I think, and this is my idea, you can counter it if you want, but I think that we find this appealing because it is how we think. It's how the world viscerally feels to us, that we rise and fall. The riddle of the Sphinx, what is it that has four legs at dawn, two and at noon, and three in the evening? And the answer is man, because we crawl, then we stand, and then we lean on a cane. And that, again, is this whole rising and falling thing. So it's actually part of how we think of narratives. As I said earlier, I'm just going to focus on one aspect of the book that deals with this idea of how it affects us viscerally. We assign values to up there and down here, and I was thinking about popular culture, and I realized that there are some distinctions we can make. If you're looking at cartoons, well, there are three ways of thinking about characters and their relationship to gravity. You can deny gravity, which we'll see in a moment. You can try to defeat gravity, or you can defy gravity. And I'll show you examples of each of these so that you see what I mean and how it's just so much incorporated in who we are culturally. So, this is from a short, Mary Melody's short called Heckling Hare, and it's with Bugs Bunny. And this is, the idea in cartoons is that we don't take falling seriously. We know that the characters will somehow deny the existence of gravity in order to survive. You know, Wile E. Coyote is forever falling to the desert floor, and in the next scene, he's up and he's running again, and we don't stop to think, wait a minute. Oops, sorry. Sorry. We didn't have a chance to test it beforehand. Which one is it? Which knob?
Oh, behind you on the little
one. Oh,
I'm the speaker.
Rest in peace, poor little bunny.
Oh, you darling.
Might be the longest fall in movie history. It takes about 40 seconds. To deny the existence of gravity in some way. Now I'm going to turn to Hitchcock, because I found that Hitchcock actually has a moral code attached to this idea. Here we have Norman Lloyd, who is still alive, he's 104. The villain in Saboteur here is hanging from the Statue of Liberty, and he's the villain, and he will fall, to no surprise there. Here we have the heroine in a similar pose. And anybody know what movie this is?
North.
And and watch how the morality plays out here. Good guy, right? The two heroes. He's the guy, so he's more. The villain. Anybody think they're going to fall? Oh, sorry. It's the wrong thing again. Here, the hero has to defeat gravity. right, has to pull themselves up. And in fact, the term cliffhanger, I found out in my research, comes from a Thomas Hardy novel in the 1870s, where for the first time, the two heroes are hanging from a cliff. At the end, it was a weekly serial, and at the end, or a monthly serial, and that's how chapter 22 or whatever ended. And then it wasn't called the cliffhanger then, but over the next few decades, that's the name that it acquired because of that. That's just parenthetical. But once you see gravity, as I did, you start to see it everywhere. So, so in Hitchcock's moral code, that's very straightforward. You know, the villain falls, the hero survives. And here, what is this from?
Rear Window.
Here we have James Stewart in a cast because of an accident, and he is morally compromised. He's a hero, but he's a compromised hero because he's a voyeur. He's spying on the people across the courtyard. He's interfering in their lives, and interfering in their lives actually helps him solve a murder. But it's still, there's the moral question of, are you allowed to spy on other people in the hopes that you're going to solve a murder? So he's morally compromised. Here we see him at the beginning, and here we see him at the end. So is he going to fall? Well, he's a hero, but as I said, he's compromised. And that's what happens. He does fall, as we see here. It's a very quick clip. And then he winds up like this. So that's his punishment. He gets to live, but he gets another broken line. And here's an even more morally compromised hero, almost a villain. Hero slash villain in the movie? Vertigo, right. So Jimmy Stewart has become obsessive. He's changed this woman into this figment of his imagination, and he has vertigo, but at the end, the woman falls to her death, and he, you can see, he's cured of his vertigo in that moment that she falls. But he's also damned, because now he's cured, as I say in the book, he's cured, but he's coreless. He has to live. He has a fate, I think, worse than death, is that he has to live with himself now. But that, again, is part of this this moral universe that Hitchcock creates that draws on our visceral understanding. Okay, so we have cartoon characters denying gravity. We have dramatic characters who need to defeat it or not, depending on whether or not they're good or bad. And here he is in purgatory, neither up nor down, neither on the ground nor in the sky. And that leaves one other element, which is defying gravity. When I talked about walking before, that's what we're doing. We're defying gravity, right? We're surrendering to it, and then we're saying, nope, not so fast, we're gonna take a step. That's a step, right? So here is an illustration of how that kind of fortitude works.
Could you tell me where 1127 Walnut Avenue is?
1127 Walnut Avenue?
Yes, sir.
That's the house up there, right on top of the stoop.
That's the house up there, right on top of the stoop. Steady, Susan.
Okay. So they will have to defy gravity to get that piano up the steps. Obviously, obviously they're doing a riff on Sisyphus, right? They're gonna go, they're gonna try to get the rock up the hill and it's gonna fall down. But they have to persist. I mean, they have to persevere. Because that's what we do. So here they are, they succeed in getting it up. And that victory doesn't last very long. And they're going to try again, because what else can you do? And again. Something that, the more I wrote about the book and thought about it, is that I saw that this is kind of noble. This kind of, you know, that walking is noble in a way, standing up is noble, because we are actually defying gravity. We know how it's going to end, we know how the story ends, we're not going to be able to defy gravity forever, right? That's why they call it the grave, gravitas, grave, gravity. But we try. And as I thought about that, those earlier images of the Earth rotating and revolving and moving around the center of the solar system, or the galaxy, and the galaxy moving, and all of that, this simple idea of this dropping or falling down the stairs or whatever starts to take on a different meaning for me. It's not a meaning that I can always grasp. It's not something that I walk around with all the time. But I find it fun and moving and mysterious. And I hope that if you read the book, or at least think back on this talk, that you'll think about it the same way. And that leaves us with where we started. So, thank you. Well, Einstein, in formulating the general theory of relativity, said, you know, we know that things at the surface of the Earth fall 32 feet per second squared, meaning that they fall 32 feet every second, and they also accelerate at that rate. So they're falling 32 feet, but then 32 feet faster, etc. And he said that at the surface of the Earth, if you were inside an elevator, and the elevator was completely closed off, you would have no way of distinguishing between the elevator being on the surface of the Earth or the elevator rising through space at 32 feet per second squared. It would feel the same to you. And that, so you're saying that yes, that it has different effects depending on how you think about it. You know, that it manifests itself. You can think about the manifestation in different ways. Yes?
I've heard Thomer thought that gravity was a meaningless question.
Yeah.
What is the scientific so-called equivalent to the problem, whatever the problem is? Is it a mathematical problem? Is it a scientific problem? Because the mystery seems to be in what's the problem almost.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And in fact, the introduction ends with me going off on talking about gravity as that my pursuit of gravity leads me to think about the question of what gravity, I'll just read you at the very end of it. The question of what gravity is, or quote, is, has never been strictly about physics. It's always also been metaphysical. It's always also been philosophical. How we think about gravity, whether we think about gravity, has directed civilization for centuries, millennia even, back before we had a word for what we would one day try and so far fail to define. Gravity isn't just something that guides our every negotiation with the material world, it's something even more mysterious. It's something that's evident in the creation of creation myths, the illusions of religion, the effects in an IMAX spectacular. It's something we reflexively incorporate into the subtlest recesses of our civilizations and our psyches. It's something that has defined our scientific conception of the universe, even the multiverse, and it's something that has defined our conception of ourselves. It's the greatest ghost in the grandest machine. Oh, the philosophical, Kip Thorne said, in that case. So it defeats you scientifically. Unless we find the graviton, that subatomic particle, the hypothetical subatomic particle that would mediate between matter and the universe to create the effect that we call gravitation. So it's a scientific problem. Not so much mathematical, except that the math of general relativity and quantum mechanics don't match, which is why when we say we get to the surface of a black hole, we don't know what's inside the black hole, because that's where the equations fall apart. The two equations inside the black hole, the quantum equations and the equations outside general relativity, don't match. So that's a mathematical problem.
Does it also seem to express a question about the relationship
Well, they're different forms of each other.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yes.
Does your book at all touch on what seems to be the liveliest dispute among scientists now, which is about dark matter?
My last book. I mentioned dark matter and dark energy in this book because they are, as was mentioned at the beginning, dark energy is 68.something% of the universe, dark matter is another 25 or something like that, and then the rest of it is 4 or 5%, that's the stuff of us in the library and so on. And my last book was called The 4% Universe, Dark Matter, Dark Energy, and the Race to Discover the Rest of Reality. So that book deals much more with dark matter, but I do mention dark matter and dark energy here because dark matter is a problem that manifests itself through gravitation, and so does dark energy because it's the acceleration of the expansion of the universe. So the universe is doing something that we intuitively think it shouldn't be doing. In a universe full of matter that interacts gravitationally, you would expect an expansion to be slowing down. And instead, it seems to be speeding up. So yes, I touch on them, but briefly. If you want the in-depth stuff, it's the previous book. Anybody else? Yes?
Two questions. Is gravity proportional to density and size of a celestial object?
Yes, it is.
It is. So, I don't know, to me it seems, I don't know why it seems, I want to figure out, but because there are so much evidence for it. The other thing was, was it observed that when two black holes merged, that was something that created a measurable distortion in gravity?
Right.
Was that assumed?
No, that's the LIGO experiment, and what they did is they had two long passages where they would you could beam a light back and forth, and it goes back and forth several hundred times, and it's called an interferometer, and a light signal that goes in one direction, goes in the other direction, and gets reflected back. We'll have to come back at the same time because that's the speed of light, right? And this is an extraordinary experiment. It was like, I don't know, a mile long, each of the arms, something like that. And so they had to account for the curvature of the Earth, and like it's like 10 feet or 10 meters higher at one point than at the other, just to keep it straight. So they had to take all of these things into account. And then bounce the light back and forth. And when this detection happened, it's because the two beams of light didn't meet back at the same time. I mean, it's so minuscule that it's unbelievable. We're talking about, the example I gave was that it's like the distance to the nearest star is 4.2 3 light years, I think, which is, you know, trillions and trillions of miles. And the detection that they made was like the measurement, the width of a proton compared to the distance to the nearest star. So it's, I mean, it was so exquisite. And because of that distortion, they could conclude, I mean, it matched predictions. That's the way science works. You do the math, you make the prediction, and you see if it happens, and then you repeat and repeat and repeat. So.
So the distortion in the light was what was observed, not the actual merging. They're assuming that it's two black holes merging. That's the only thing that could cause it, they assume.
That there are different signatures for different events. So they expected to see a supernova explosion, that they would detect that first, or two neutron stars colliding. And instead, they found two black holes. And then shortly after that, they found two more black holes. And they're kind of, I think that collisions of black holes might be more common than we thought. and since then, they have detected neutron star collisions and black hole neutron stars and everything. Yes.
But how did they know that it was the collision of the two black holes that caused that?
They actually had two experiments, and the two have to match.
No.
Okay.
How did they know it was the black holes as opposed to something else?
Again, it's math. It's in the signature of the math, and I don't know enough about it. I'm not a scientist. Yes?
Can you say maybe some mathematical aspects and physical aspects to the world of which you are totally ignorant now, and which we need to get some solutions which are avoiding this at this point?
Oh, totally. You mentioned dark matter. And
yeah.
One of the astronomers who found the best evidence for dark matter, her name is Vera Rubin. She died just a couple of years ago. But she discovered the evidence. Everybody else said, well, this is the evidence for something called dark matter. And I saw her not long before her death, maybe 3 or 4 years. And we were talking. We got to be sort of friends. And she said, you know, the older I get, the more I think that that there probably isn't dark matter, but it's something else.
She said,
in 500 years, we're going to have a completely different understanding of the universe. I'm sorry that I'm not going to be around to see it. So the math will be different. I'm going to call it elsewhere. Yeah, just
did the Higgs boson come into this at all?
The what?
The Higgs boson.
Well, the Higgs boson explains mass, but it doesn't. But it doesn't explain gravity. The graviton would do that. Okay. Yes?
There was a meeting, a panel actually, at the World Science Festival in June, where dark matter was argued. Some scientists explained it in terms of neutrinos. There were various candidates.
Yeah.
But one scientist named Eric Verlinde from the University of Amsterdam said there is no such thing. Our math is wrong at that scale.
Could be.
And it's actually an interaction of matter with dark energy. So they were really at odds about what's causing this behavior.
Yeah.
We need a lot to learn, and you agree about that.
Yes. Well, one of the great things about science is, I mean, we tend to think about science as a quest to find answers, but actually, if you talk to scientists, it's a quest to find answers, yes, but it's a quest to find better questions, cooler questions.
One or two more questions.
Yes.
Yeah, you mentioned that the gravity seemed working between two small objects and even between galaxies.
Mm-hmm.
What is the explanation now that science gives for the fact that the galaxies are accelerating away from each other more rapidly than they expected?
Right, that's dark energy, and they don't have an explanation for that. In fact, the evidence for dark energy was discovered in 1998, and for about 15 years, it really drove physics to the extent that some physicists were worried that it was kind of, you know, that it was monopolizing the discussion and that they were falling behind in other areas. And in the end, we still don't know. So the answer is probably, I think that most people would say at this point, the answer is in solving that lack of compatibility between quantum and general relativity. That we're going to have to figure that out in order to figure out dark energy. But And there was one other question, yes?
Well, I'm wondering, is there a tie-in between the magma in the middle of the Earth with the gravity that surrounds us?
Well, the mass of the magma would have an effect on it. How much the mass is, I mean, that's what would determine the effect of gravity. Okay, well, thank you very much. I really appreciate it.